We're so happy to have the Reverend with us, Cornell Brooks, who's the 18th president of the NAACP. And I wanted to begin our conversation today to talking about how you grew up, how you saw the world, how you got involved in each step of the way, and how you've ended up here as the 18th president.
Sure, sure. So when you talk about my background, I am a fourth-generation minister in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And it is, for those of you who may not know, is America's oldest African-American denomination and the only American denomination to come into being not as a consequence of a matter of theology or theological schism, but as a matter of social protest. So in the late 1700s, African-Americans in the city of Philadelphia, under the leadership of Richard Allen, who was a freed slave, declined to be segregated in St. George's Episcopal Church. And so as a consequence, they walked out of the church, formed a self-help organization and an insurance company, if you will, because in the late 1700s, people declined to bury African-Americans. So they formed their own burial society, their own self-help organization, which later came to be the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Now, I say that because my life was really formed in the context of a religious body dedicated to social justice. So when I was a little boy in Georgetown, South Carolina, my grandfather, who was a barber as well as a preacher, he would tell me these stories about running for Congress in the late 1940s. I didn't really believe him, but when I got older, I discovered that the stories he told me were in fact true. He ran for Congress because Thurgood Marshall won a case in the Supreme Court called Smith versus Allwright, which outlawed the all-white Southern Democratic primary, which meant that if African Americans couldn't participate in the Democratic primary in the all-Democratic South, they couldn't participate in the political process. So when that case came down from the Supreme Court, and there was a federal district court decision in South Carolina along that time as well, my grandfather ran for Congress. Now, the reason he ran for Congress was not because he thought he could win. He didn't consult a Gallup poll. He didn't take any scientific surveys, but he understood that if he ran for Congress, he could energize and excite people about voting and joining the NAACP, which was at that time an extraordinarily dangerous thing to do. My grandmother and grandfather told me about how they would meet in the funeral parlor on Sundays after church, and everybody would come by different means. Some people would drive, some people actually rode horses, some people would walk, but no one would tell anybody where they were going and why they were doing that. And so growing up with those kinds of stories, hearing about the NAACP, hearing about the risk that people took on to become members of the NAACP, implanted a yearning, if you will, in my heart to do social justice work and civil rights work. So that put me on the path to ministry and law and eventually coming to the NAACP as president.
And talking about ministry, I remember that I read a story, I think it was a profile in the Washington Post, and it talked about when you were at Jackson State that you had listened to a guest lecturer. Who was it that you were listening to who gave you the advice to the audience, which you took up? And then tell our audience what that advice was, because I think one particular part of that also was key in leading to the ministry.
Sure. So, true story, I was a college, I think, freshman or sophomore, and Stokely Carmichael, a key figure in the Black Power movement in the 1960s, came to my college campus and he gave a speech. And in the speech, he asked three questions. My college was a historically black college. A great many of the students were Christians, self-described. And he asked these three questions. He said, how many of you believe in the Bible? Everyone raised their hands. And he said, well, how many of you have read it from cover to cover? No one raised their hand. How many of you believe that, generally speaking, America is a great country? Everybody raised their hands, and then he asked, well, how many of you read the Constitution from beginning to end? Then he asked the question, how many of you believe that Martin Luther King was a great man? Everyone raised their hands. He said, how many of you have read all of his books? No one. So as a consequence of those questions, where I, frankly, not being able to answer in the affirmative to any of them, I felt incredibly ignorant. And so I resolved to read the Constitution from beginning to end, to read the Bible from cover to cover, and to read all of the works of Martin Luther King. And so as a consequence, that led me down a path in terms of becoming interested in the law, and in terms of ministry, reading Dr. King's works and then reading the works of Walter Rauschenbusch, reading the works of Paul Tillich, Moltmann, and some of the theologians of the day, and that influenced the moral philosophy of Dr. King, including the Boston Personalists, that were a part of the intellectual legacy of Boston University School of Theology. Long story made short, a few years later, I end up at Boston University as a Martin Luther King scholar, studying his papers, studying under Walter Mulder, who was the dean who admitted Dr. King, and then going on to Yale Law School to become a civil rights lawyer. The point being is you got to be very careful about the questions you listen to, because they can really influence your life in disastrous ways.
So if we take the work that you're doing now, and you know, not too long ago, celebrate the 100th anniversary, and let's talk about its relevance to today. So you're leading an organization, it's over 100 years old, and so when people say to you, well, tell me the relevance of it today. You know, we have a black president, we have this, we have that. So what are you doing?
Yes, so a year and a half ago, I came into this position, and I think that was the first question of the first perhaps 50 interviews. Why is the NAACP relevant? Which is another way of asking the question, why is this anachronistic organization still in existence? Well, it's really interesting. The contemporary history and circumstances of the moment have conspired to render that question irrelevant. Meaning, I took the job 1 week, didn't have a chance to unpack my bags in the Baltimore headquarters, went to our national convention. On the second day of the convention, Eric Garner lost his life in Staten Island. A few weeks later, Ferguson. A few weeks later, Tamir Rice. Then the Charleston Nine. Then Cleveland. Chicago. All across this country, we have seen day in and day out, whether you're reading the newspaper, scanning your mobile device, listening to the news, watching the news, everything in this country demonstrates the degree to which the NAACP is relevant. Consider, this being the 150th anniversary of the 13th Amendment, barring involuntary servitude, this being the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery March, the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. What do we see all across the country? Voting rights being imperiled. We see in the post-Shelby versus Holder political landscape, the rights of young people, as well as African Americans, as well as Latinos, as well as people with disabilities and seniors being imperiled all across the country. We see voting rights challenges as well as criminal justice challenges. One of the first things I did was to come to New York City to meet with Commissioner Bratton, to meet with the Inspector General, to meet with the county prosecutor concerning Eric Garner's death. Then meeting with the governor in Missouri, then marching 134 miles with the NAACP across Missouri, then marching from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C., 1,004 miles. Meeting with mayors, governors, senators all across the country, meeting with folks in the middle of the night and having discussions with them about what we can do to ensure that they bring about the reform that is necessary in terms of criminal justice while ensuring that their cities do not burn down, literally, not metaphorically. All of those things demonstrate the degree to which the NAACP is relevant. There's no other organization, I want to be clear about this, there's no other organization in the country where you have 2,000 branches in prisons, in colleges, high schools, workplaces, every major city, 5 military installations abroad, small towns all across the country, and no paid staff outside of Baltimore and D.C. All volunteers, hundreds of thousands of people. And these are the people, and I got to say this, who show up. No press release, no press conference, no cameras. They show up at school board meetings, zoning meetings, and they do real work. And not just 70-year-olds. Grandmothers, yes, lots of them, okay? All of whom are quite pleased to tell you what to do, even as CEO. But also lots of young people. So when we marched from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C., we had high schoolers. And when we got to D.C. to talk about the Voting Rights Act, hundreds of high schoolers and colleges and college students going door to door in Congress talking about the right to vote. Right now, in 2016, we're going into the first federal presidential election without the full protection of the Voting Rights Act. The weakest Voting Rights Act in 50 years. This is a time when the NAACP has to be at its best. We have to put boots on the ground, but we also have to build some broad coalitions. Because right now, when we talk about the right to vote, people think of it as the movie, 1965, Selma, black and white. That is profoundly wrong. What we're seeing in terms of disenfranchisement, when you don't honor college IDs, you're impairing not only the African Americans, the right to vote of African Americans in terms of the 14th Amendment, but also the right of the rights of young people in terms of the 26th Amendment. We've got to do more here. And so we've got to organize, form broader coalitions, obviously do more social media outreach, build a deeper bench in terms of our analytic capacity. I think it's key for us to establish an affirmative right to vote under the Constitution. Not merely barring the prohibitions or the things that impede the right to vote, but establishing an affirmative right to vote. And I would simply say here, that's number one on our agenda. I would hope it would be number one on yours as well.
Right. Ladies and gentlemen, please thank our guests for being here today with us.